Let's get out and say straight away that most of what you see online that's claiming to be deepfake isn't deepfake, right? It's some kind of visual effects of some description, right? People being made to look younger in movies, that isn't at the moment done with deep networks. They're not that good yet. You know, there's been some very impressive demonstrations. How much of that is deep learning isn't always disclosed. But I'm really interested in the topic because I don't think that deepfakes are that convincing yet, but I think they will be convincing in 5 or 10 years. And then we have some serious problems. Deepfakes usually trained with a lot of pictures of one person and another person, and a network learns to basically convert them over. Now, one of the things about being on Computerphile is we have quite a back catalogue of videos of, for example, me and Steve. So I had a go at this, I trained it up, and it's the stuff of nightmares.
Yeah, so they were developing all this.
It doesn't work amazingly all the time. It doesn't handle, you know, when the view goes off and things like this. But on the other hand, for something where I basically just put in a bunch of source material, it kind of did it. You know, that's pretty impressive. There's a lot of stuff, a lot of talk about GANs and things like this. Actually, a lot of deepfake isn't GANs, but they are encoder-decoder networks like we've talked about before. We have videos on GANs and we have a video on autoencoders or encoder-decoders, depending on what your preference is. The problem we're trying to solve is that we're trying to take a face and turn it into a different face, right? Or it's basically trying to draw someone's face on top of an existing one, right? And that allows you to take a source video, locate the face in it, in each frame, and then paint on the new face, right? And theoretically replace someone. Now, there's a lot more to faking than this. You've got to do the voice, the hair, and things like this, right? And one of the problems, if I'm trying to transfer my face onto someone who doesn't look anything like me, is that it doesn't look good, even if the face is good.
Most people who've taken an interest in this will have seen this famous Tom Cruise lookalike video.
It's very, very impressive, right? How much is visual effects and deep learning, I don't know. But the actor looks a lot like Tom Cruise to begin with, right? It wasn't going to work with me as the base. How do we train a deep fake, right? So let's suppose we're taking person A and we're trying to turn them into person B. So we need to first collect a load of faces of each person, right? And to do that, we can use existing deep networks. So for example, there are networks which will find the key landmarks on your face. There are networks which will detect face. We've done face recognition before. And so what that means is you can take a video or a series of videos and find, align and crop out the faces essentially automatically, and that makes your training process much, much easier. So you do this, and let's say you collect, I know, 5,000 pictures of me and 5,000 pictures of Steve, right? And you crop right down to the face level, because if you have a load of arm waving in it, that's a much harder image generation problem, which is for another day, right? If the person is front and center and just looking like this, then maybe you can get away with fewer images. But if they're looking and doing this and they're smiling and, you know, facial expressions, for the network to learn all those different mappings, you need lots more data. Not to mention things like lighting changes at different areas and stuff. Right, so this is person A. I don't know why I've drawn a full person on here, because that doesn't make sense, right? This is person B. So these are cropped images of faces, not old people, right? Sort that out in post for me, please. So the deep network we're using here is called an autoencoder, right? I often refer to it as an encoder decoder, right? Because it's just in the literature that I use, that seems to be what it's called, but it's not really important. The important thing is that you have a piece of network here which downsamples your image, makes it smaller, but also extracts interesting features, and it turns it into features. And this is called the encoder. So this is an E for encoder, right? And we have another encoder here. Now, actually, these are the same one. These have the exact same neural network weights. They're trained in the same way, and we have features here. An example of this kind of network is the one when we talked about face recognition, trying to take someone's face and put it into that space where you can just determine who they are, right? That's essentially what this is doing. This is going to be some 500, 1,000, 2,000 digit barcode, shall we say, representing all the interesting aspects of their face. Then we have a decoder. So the decoder is essentially the exact opposite. It makes the image bigger again and returns it back to the original size. And we're trying to produce another face which is an exact copy of this first one. Right, so this is the decoder. Now, what's interesting about these deepfake technologies is the encoder is shared, right, which means that essentially the same encoder is used to turn A into features and B into features, but the decoder is unique to each person. So this might be Mike's decoder and this might be Steve's decoder. And so how you train this is you just put in a load of images of me, you've put them through this encoder decoder, and you try and get as close a copy of me out. Now, if you think this isn't an image in here, this is sort of high level feature information. So this is essentially compression, right? It's got to downsample this whole image into a very small feature space of just the most really important information, and then it's going to turn it back into an image. And the same here. It's going to take a picture of Steve or someone else, going to downsample them into the feature space, and then it's going to upsample them back. Because the whole point of this network is you're trying to make sure this matches this and this matches this, if your feature space isn't a good representation of your face, you're not going to be able to do that, right? So that's why the features end up useful, right? This is what autoencoders do. They turn your input into a latent space or a feature space, and then you turn this back into the image, right? The encoder is a set of instructions that take a face and summarize it, and then the decoder is that takes that summary and turns it back into an image, right? And it's going to include things like orientation and stuff like this. Now, how do we actually turn me into Steve or vice versa, right? All we do, we train this all up, so we make sure A looks like the output of A, B looks like the output of B. There are other generative adversarial versions of this you could use, right? But this is just nice and straightforward. And then all we do, suppose we want to turn Steve into me, we put in a picture of Steve, right? We encode it into this shared feature representation, which is, you know, what pose has he got. But then we use Mike's decoder. So we switch this decoder out for my one. We turn an image of the person we are trying to change, we turn them into the feature space, and then we use someone else's decoder to return them to a different face, right? That's how it works. And then you get a nice picture of me out. Nice is relative. Right. And you know, I've trained this up and it works pretty well, right? It's a little bit weird.
Wireless networking, older than you didn't believe.
It was super straightforward, right? I just got a load of videos from you, right? Which downloading them was the slowest part. And then I basically, it automatically extracted all the faces, aligned them all nicely, and then I essentially just trained it from there. And I played around with a couple of the networks involved, read up on what they did. But basically, it holds your hand through the whole process. And then at the end, you can put in a video and it'll give you out a video with my face instead of Steve's. There's obviously a lot of problems with it, right? First of all, the networks are still not quite high resolution enough to deal with, you know, 1080 and 4K video. You know, I didn't put in enough training data. I put in quite a bit, but not enough, not varied enough. If you were really committed to providing incredibly impressive output, you would need to pay a lot more attention and train it for a lot longer than I did, right? I was just seeing how things go. It heats up my whole house, this graphics card, when I train on it. So I was too hot, so I turned it off.
This seems like a bit of a one-trick pony, right?
Well, actually, so DeepFake, or this sort of image-to-image conversion, which is really what it is, it's quite common outside of faces as well. So, for example, satellite imagery, right? People are using it for MRI to try and convert between one kind of scanner and another, because then you can get a deep network that works on both and things like this. There's loads of times where style transfer, which is a sort of what this is a subset of, is really, really useful, right? So there's a huge amount of research happening, not just in faces, but in other domains as well, right? Some of it's like this, some of it's using StyleGAN, CycleGAN, you know, it depends, right? But yeah, this is a pretty broad area. For me, these networks are pretty standard networks that I use day to day. They're somewhat interesting, right? But I'm interested in what happens to this in a few years' time when these networks start to become really, really good, right? Because, you know, the pace at which deep learning is improving is impressive, right? Not at every task, right? It doesn't just solve everything. But you've got to imagine that for low quality CCTV, the kind of stuff that needs to hold up in court or something like this, it's not going to be that many years before we can completely replace faces or other things, objects in those scenes, right? And we have to be prepared for that. We're long since past the idea that you could put a lid on this, right? And I'm not saying that would even be a good thing, right? So for example, I used a GitHub repository called FaceSwap to do my training, right? Really cool. Download it, have a go, for legitimate reasons, please. But it has something like 30,000 stars on GitHub, 10,000 forks. You know, people are using this in bulk, right? And this is not the only one. You can't ban this kind of technology because it's just academic discovery, right? And the other thing is that if you try and ban it, you end up in a situation where only a certain people who already understand it still have access to some technology and no one else can access it, right? And that isn't going to solve any problems, right? You could imagine a situation where only people with resources could tamper videos and not everyone else, and then you've got a whole different set of problems. You've not really got a solution.
And anyway, in the list of things it says, please don't use this for illegal activities, isn't
right?
It?
Problem
so,
solved, yeah.
So
I mean,
right.
No, like, I mean, DeepFake has obviously been in the news because it is used a lot for illegitimate activity, right? For putting faces on things, for faking politicians' words and stuff. I would prefer to focus not on the fact that it's being used for those things, but some kind of solutions we might think about as to how we actually fix those problems. Because they're not going to stop just because we asked nicely, right? We have to think about, you know, in 10 years' time, when you can't tell the difference between A and B, what do we do then, right? Can you still use video evidence, right? Can you trust anything you see on a social media site that has someone talking, if they can fake video and audio perfectly well? No, not really, right? So there are some solutions to this that people are exploring. So the most obvious one would just be, this is a problem caused by deep learning, right? We'll solve it with deep learning. So we just take a video or a picture, we put it into a classifier trained on deepfakes and say, is it fake or not, right? This is, you know, the adversarial approach. It works okay. I mean, it's going to be dependent on getting enough video data. Will it work on the videos of me? Don't know, probably, but will it generalize? I don't know. What you end up happening is that people are researching better techniques to perform image conversion, and then someone develops a better way of detecting it, and you just go like this, and the whole thing, you know, you...
It's like virus detection, right?
It's just like antivirus and virus detection, right? The viruses become more sophisticated, they encrypt themselves and things like this, and it becomes harder to check and so on. You have to come up with new techniques. So I think that deep learning does have a role to play in trying to detect stuff like this. I suppose what I'm wondering about is what happens when they become so good that it is impossible to tell the difference, right? Now, I don't know how likely that is, but I would say pretty likely, given that for an image, we're only talking about a few hundred pixels across, right? You can make pretty convincing facsimiles using CGI already, right? So doing this automatically does not seem out of a question. I think that probably cryptography has a pretty big role to play. You know, there are mechanisms in cryptography, like message authentication codes, to stop messages being tampered with, right? There's digital certificates to verify ownership of some kind of file or message, right? You could imagine that if these things were built into like CCTV cameras, you couldn't tamper with the message because you wouldn't be able to recompute the signature and things like this, right? I've not thought this through, right? There were people in the comments, do discuss it in the comments, right? And tell me why I'm wrong. But it seems to me that cryptographic techniques to stop things being tampered with and make sure you know where things have come from and who signed what, they have a role to play in trying to stop some of this, I think, right? Those things don't exist in this area yet, right? We have stuff like digital watermarking, but it's all pretty low key. More research is going to be needed here pretty soon, I'd say. Ciphertext that we'll be breaking later.
Does it honestly start with Zeus, as in Conrad Zeus?
Yeah.
In the reality of random, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. You see all kinds of words in the random ciphertext and they mean absolutely nothing.
Another row of characters became, as it were, normal to the paper and could be...